हेलो माय डियर क्यूरियस एंड स्टूडियस स्टूडेंट्स ऑफ सर्जरी, माय सेल्फ डॉक्टर महेश चौधरी, आई एम वार्म वेलकमिंग यू इन माय सर्जरी लेक्चर सीरीज। दिस सर्जरी लेक्चर सीरीज कंटेन्स एंटायर सर्जरी विथ एनेस्थेसिया, विथ रेडियोलॉजी, विथ ऑर्थोपेडिक, सो स्टे ट्यून विथ अस। लेट्स स्टार्ट आवर सर्जरी लेक्चर सीरीज। वेलकम डियर फ्रेंड्स इन माय सर्जरी लेक्चर सीरीज नंबर 22, दैट इज द डायवर्टिकुला ऑफ स्मॉल इंटेस्टाइन। इन दिस लेक्चर we will learn diverticula of small intestine, that is the Meckel's diverticulum and the complications of McCarthy diverticulum, Meckel's diverticulum, duodenal diverticulum, blind loop syndrome, short bowel syndrome, typhoid enteritis, neoplasm, benign tumors of the small intestine, Peutz-Jeghers syndrome, malignant neoplasm, malignant tumors of the small intestine and the carcinoids. Okay, let's start with me. First we will start from the diverticula of small intestine. First is the Meckel's diverticulum. Meckel's diverticulum is present in only 2% of cases. 2 feet proximal to the ileocecal wall, it is usually 2 inches in length and is found on the anti-mesenteric border of the ileum. It possesses a mesentery-like mesoappendix through which its blood supply is maintained. It contains all the layer of the small intestine and in many respects it is similar to appendix. In 1/5 of cases, it contains heterotopic epithelium like gastric, colonic and rarely pancreatic tissue. This heterotopic epithelium usually lies in the proximal end of the diverticulum and not frequently. It also extends for a short distance into the nearby ileum. There are two varieties. One is congenital and second is acquired. Congenital contains all the three layers and acquired contains only mucus and submucus but not muscular coat, due to increased interluminal pressure and mucosa herniates. That's why the acquired Meckel's diverticulum is developed. Now the clinical features can only be detected when some complication occurs in it. Without complication, Meckel's diverticulum remains silent. Dear friends, here is a good picture on your screen you are watching. There is a congenital acquired Meckel's diverticulum is also seeing on your screen. Next picture is, this is a typical picture of the congenital Meckel's diverticulum, contains all three layers. This is the another image. There is a fibrous cord with the abdominal wall, anterior abdominal wall connected with the umbilicus. This is the next image of the Meckel's diverticulum, clearly shown the congenital Meckel's diverticulum. This is the Meckel's diverticulum, elongated, looks like the appendix. Now the complications of Meckel's diverticulum: intestinal obstruction due to the band intersusception, bleeding due to peptic ulceration produced by ectopic gastric mucosa, that is the malina, is a common symptoms. Meckel's diverticulitis due to lodgement of food residues within it. Chronic peptic ulceration due to ectopic gastric mucosa. Literal hernia when the diverticulum may be found in an inguinal or femoral hernia. Now the diagnosis by the radiography: barium mill is not very significant. Technetium 99 TCM scanning is helpful, particularly during hemorrhage taking place from the diverticulum. Diagnostic accuracy is about 90% in technetium scanning. Now the treatment is excision of Meckel's diverticulum. Base of the diverticulum should be included in the resection. And next topic is duodenal diverticulum. Duodenal diverticulum has the two types. One is primary and second is secondary. Primary is same as acquired diverticulum and easily found on the inner wall of the second and third parts of the duodenum. These primary types of the duodenal diverticulum do not produce symptoms and accidentally discovered by barium mill X-ray. Secondary type of the duodenal diverticulum is the secondary to scarring of the peptic ulcer and is usually seen in the duodenal cap. The treatment, if the asymptomatic diverticula requires no treatment and when causes, resection should be done. Now the complication of the duodenal diverticulum are should be rejected and resected and end-to-end anastomosis should be performed. Here is a good picture on your screen is seeing the duodenal diverticulum. All the three layers are seen in this diverticulum. This is the good picture of barium mill showing the duodenal diverticulum. Now the next point of this lecture is blind loop syndrome. What is the blind loop syndrome? When there is a stagnation of small intestine contained by stricture, stenosis, blind pouch formation or diverticula, the bacterial flora in the stagnant area are altered both in number and in kind. This produces a symptoms complex such as anemia, hyperproteinemia, steatorrhea, etc. This is the blind loop syndrome. When occurs in proximal part, bacteria deconjugate bile salts causing disruption of mucilage solubility of fats, produces steatorrhea, also disturbs absorption of protein and other vitamins. When occurs in proximal part, abnormal bacterial flora compete for vitamin B12 producing vitamin B12 deficiency and megaloblastic anemia. Treatment of blind loop syndrome is the vitamin supplementary, but the temporary cure is found. Surgical correction of this condition which causes stagnation is the actual treatment of choice. Dear friends, you can see this image of blind loop. Here is a general blind loop into side anastomosis with the ileum. You can see on your screen jejunal bypass. This is the blind loop syndrome. This is the vitamin B12 deficiency and megaloblastic anemia. This is the another picture. You can see in the first diagram normal anatomy, and in the second diagram you can watch the Billroth second operation, that is the gastrojejunostomy. There is a duodenal stump, blind loop and afferent loop. You can see now the short bowel syndrome. Massive resection of small bowel will produce this syndrome. That is the mesenteric occlusion, volvulus, traumatic disruption of superior mesenteric vessels, recurrent Crohn's disease. This type of massive small intestine resection may be needed. 70% of resection can be tolerated when lower ileum and IC valve can be preserved. Otherwise, nutrition can be severely impaired by even 50% of small bowel resection. There are mainly problems of absorption of fat, water, electrolytes and vitamin B12. Treatment of short bowel syndrome is the Lomotil or the Codeine will slow intestinal motility and help more absorption from the small intestine. Oral calcium carbonate will decrease diarrhea by neutralizing hydrochloric acid. The hope of future is probably allograft transplantation of a segment of intestine. Dear friends, you can see the next image on your screen is the ileocolonic anastomosis, jejunocolonic anastomosis, and third diagram is the end jejunostomy. All these are the short bowel syndromes, develops short bowel syndromes. This is the another picture. You can see due to the volvulus or intersubstitution or obstruction, the major part of the jejunum and ileum has been resected and anastomosis is there. Before surgery and after surgery, you can see the good picture on your screen. Now the typhoid enteritis. Typhoid enteritis is mainly a medical disease which is caused by the Salmonella typhi. This main concern of the surgeon is that in this disease there is a hyperplasia and ulceration of Peyer's patches of the intestine, mesenteric lymphadenopathy, and to less extent parenchymal changes in the liver and splenomegaly. Confirmation of diagnosis is obtained by the culturing the S typhi from blood or feces, or by finding a high titer of agglutination against the O and H antigens of the organisms. Complications of the typhoid enteritis are intestinal hemorrhage, perforation, paralytic ileus, and cholecystitis. Treatment is both. If there is no Peyer's patches or ulceration or perforation, then only medical treatment is needed. And if there is a multiple perforation due to the typhoid enteritis, then surgical intervention is mandatory and must. This is the Peyer's patches on the intestine. You can see in this image another image of typhoid enteritis. Now the next point of this lecture is the neoplasm. Tumors of the small intestine are uncommon. Colonic neoplasms occurs 40 times as frequently as small intestine neoplasm. But the peculiarity of small intestine tumors is that benign and malignant neoplasms occurs with equal frequency. Benign, first we will see the benign neoplasms. Benign neoplasms are leiomyoma, lipoma, adenoma, polyp, hemangioma, fibroma, neurogenic tumors, fibromyoma, myxomas, etc. 50% of benign neoplasms are found in duodenum, 25% in jejunum, and 60% in ileum, particularly in distal one-third part of the ileum. Clinical features of benign neoplasms of small intestine are that cause no serious symptoms, only bleeding and obstruction are two most common clinical manifestations. Occasionally, there may be the perforation. Investigation barium mill study is sufficient to diagnose these benign neoplasms. Only investigation tool available to detect. Now the treatment is surgically removal of these benign neoplasms. Dear students, you can watch the benign leiomyoma on your screen. This is the another benign tumor of the small intestine. Now the next point of this lecture is Peutz-Jeghers syndrome. First reported by the Peutz in 1921 and Jeghers rediscovered it with greater details in 1949. Syndrome consists, Peutz-Jeghers syndrome consists multiple intestinal polyposis and melanin spots in oral mucosa, lips, palms and hands and soles of the feet. This is hereditary disease through a simple Mendelian dominant gene. Maybe polyposis without pigmentation
or pigmentation without polyposis. Both conditions may be found. Clinical features are recurrent abdominal colicky pain caused by transient intussusception is the most frequent symptom. Treatment is excision and polypectomy. Here is the animation of Peutz-Jeghers syndrome, which is the rare autosomal dominant condition. Multiple polyps in the intestine and melanotic macules on the mucosa of the oral cavity, mouth, that is the mouth, lips, palms and soles. This is a good picture of Peutz-Jeghers syndrome. The black spots on the lips or on the oral cavity. This is the another picture of Peutz-Jeghers syndrome. Now the next point is the malignant neoplasm of the small intestine. Malignant neoplasms of the small intestine are extremely rare and comprise only 2% of gastrointestinal malignant tumors. Adenocarcinoma is the commonest, followed by the carcinoid tumor. Lymphoma and sarcoma, principally leiomyoma sarcomas. First, malignant neoplasm of the small intestine is the adenocarcinoma. This occurs at the age of 40 years and develops the symptoms like obstruction, diarrhea and chronic blood loss, that is the melena and anemia. Second malignant neoplasm is the lymphosarcoma. This tumor occurs more commonly between 30 to 40 years of age. The cell type is most frequently histiocytic lymphoma, formerly called reticulum cell sarcoma, followed by Hodgkin sarcoma and mixed cell lymphoma. Main symptoms are malabsorption with steatorrhea, loss of weight, anemia, and affected part of intestine turns into the rigid tube. The treatment is wide resection including regional lymph nodes resection. Here is a good picture of malignant neoplasm. This is the second malignant neoplasm of the small intestine. Now the next point is the carcinoid, that is the ergatafin tumors. These tumors originate from the Kaczynski cells, ergatafin cells and enterochromaffin cells, which shows affinity for silver. Cytoplasm of these cells contains granules rich in 5-hydroxytryptamine. Tumors are also endocrine in nature, that is the S-hydroxytryptamine. Malignant carcinoid syndrome, due to overproduction of the serotonin, this serotonin broken down in the liver. Clinical features of these carcinoids are cutaneous phenomenon, flushing is the commonest early symptom, face, neck, arms and upper trunk shows a dusky red hyperemia. Gradually permanent reddening of the skin may occur. Diarrhea is a significant complaint of this condition. You can see the good picture of the malignant carcinoid tumor of the small intestine on your screen. This is the gastric carcinoid tumor screen, image. Now the investigations for the carcinoids are determination of urinary, that is 5-HIAA, that is the hydroxyindole acetic acid. Normal range is less than 5 mg per day, but in this patient exceed more than 40 mg per day. Treatment of these carcinoids are local excision if primary tumor is less than 1 cm in diameter and wide resection if the primary tumor is more than 1 cm in diameter. Radical operation, that is the right hemicolectomy plus solitary metastasis in the liver, should be excised. For the malignancy, the chemotherapy should be given, that is the 5-fluorouracil and the streptozotocin. Students, here is the end of our surgery lecture number 22, that is the diverticula of small intestines contains the malignant and benign tumors. Thank you.